So this is joint work with Thomas Shrimpton over there and Bogdan Rawinski, who is around at the conference, but I can't just see him immediately. So let's start with some very simple applications of cryptology. So email encryption, you've heard of this, I hope, and secure web browsing. So you definitely heard about this because Björn just talked about it. Yeah, so some examples, OpenPGP for email encryption, TLS for secure web browsing. So then you can ask yourself the question, how does it work? So this is very high level, and I'm assuming that you, given that you're here in the audience, you know about these things. Yeah? So email encryption uses hybrid encryption. You send an ephemeral symmetric key encapsulated under the public key, and then you use this ephemeral symmetric key for symmetric encryption. For secure web browsing, you agree on a symmetric session key using the handshake protocol, and then you use it for a symmetric record layer. So that's very easy. Now the other question is, why does this work? Yeah, so for email encryption, there's the CAMDEM framework due to Victor sitting here in the front row and Ronald. So if encapsulation looks as if a random ephemeral looks as if of a random ephemeral key, and the DEM is secure, then the construction is secure. So there's a nice composition here. That is, one thing is secure, the next thing is secure, and the whole thing is secure. And then there is secure web browsing, and there's a similar argument to be made that if the handshake protocol is secure and also the record layer is secure, then the whole thing is secure. But it's much harder to argue. So if you look at the number of papers that were written after the original paper on the CAMDEM framework on revising it and making it more neat, there's very few, if any. Whereas if you look at the number of papers that talk about key agreement and TLS security, then, well, I don't know the exact count. Maybe Kenny has an indication at some point, but it's dozens, yeah. So quite a lot. So depending on your situation, these compositions, they can be complicated or they can be relatively easy. Now the next question is, where do you store your keys? So for email encryption, you could store it on your PC in memory. Now this is problematic because then somebody like Nadia might come along with a cold boot attack and recovers your private key material, and that's bad. For secure web browsing, it might be on your PC or in the cloud, but there might be leakage, so you there might be side channels, there might be hard bleed. So keys get compromised, so you want to store your keys securely. So what you want to do, you want to store your keys on what is called a hardware security module. You still have the problem that bad security policies may reveal keys, but the idea is that if you have a hardware security models, that this is a dedicated piece of equipment, and the key stays inside, and the equipment will operate on the key. So this is, for instance, this is not a real hardware security module, but this takes the place of a hardware security module for the purposes of this talk. So there is a key inside, and then you can operate with it, but you will not ever get to see the key. No? To access it, you need to say a command to it so it knows what to do. So this is what the application programming interface does, the API, and PKCS number 11 is a cryptographic API designed to use with HSMs. No? So how does this work? Well, you use this thing, the use key management, to enroll, to create, to store, to import, to export, to transport, to retire, to destroy symmetric keys, or in some cases also public keys, but we will concentrate on symmetric keys, and then also use them. Yeah? Because if you have keys, you also want to use them for encryption or authentication. So several of the things that Björn mentioned in his previous talk. So why would this work? Well, that's what we're going to talk about today. So our contribution is that we consider a very bespoke system or subset based on a subset of PKCS 11 using a situation where we can create symmetric keys. We also can wrap and unwrap using these keys, and we'll I'll have a further information about wrapping and unwrapping later if you're not familiar with it. And then you can use them for arbitrary cryptographic operations, because what you want is you want to be able to show that keys that are kept secure by the key management can be used securely, and you want to show this once and for all. You don't want to show this for authentication, then for encryption, then for authentication, authenticated encryption, then for somebody who might want to do, I don't know what, with their symmetric keys. So there's a level of abstraction that's needed here. So the technical challenge that you are going to have here is that you first need to come up with suitable definitions. So what is a secure cryptographic primitive? So this is work that has been done before in the context of TLS, because there as well they wanted to be able to combine the handshake protocol or the key agreement with as many primitives as possible. What is a secure cryptographic API? So what does that entail? And when is its key management secure? So what are the requirements you need from the key management system to be able to argue that if you combine it with a secure cryptographic primitive, then you get a secure cryptographic API? Now, one of the problems is that there might still be a situation that keys get leaked. I mean, the idea is that you use hardware security modules so keys don't get out, but perhaps keys do get out. And what you want is that the damage is as limited as possible. You don't want a situation that if one key leaks, that then all your security, even for unrelated keys, goes through the window. So this is why there's also this notion of corruption. And in some cases, corruption will actually compromise more keys, but you want to be able to argue as precisely as possible which keys are still secure to use and which keys are not. So here is a little bit of history on PKCS 11, just also to give you an idea of the complexity of the problem of dealing with the full standard. So it started in 95, and 20 with the first version by RSA, and 20 years later, the ownership of the standard had moved to OASIS, and they've published version 2.40. So some of the advantages, so these are the, if you go to the OASIS website, there will be, there's a nice YouTube video where they describe what the advantages are. So it's vendor neutral, cross-platform, it's secure by design, so that's the hope. And it supports a wide range of devices, so simple tokens and also complex ones. So one of the good things, one of the things to remember is that it supports multiple devices, so you might have lots of tokens. Yeah? Bear this in mind. Now, there's also a very nice summary by Graham Steele on version 2.20, which I quote here. It's 407 pages, so that's quite long. There's 54 commands, 224 mechanisms, 147 tables, 203 security critical footnotes. So this is the reason why we have to select a subset to start work, because if you want to prove something about 407 pages of standard, you're going to, maybe not fit within the call for papers of crypto. So the other two things that Graham mentions is that there are no clear compliance criteria, and even if things are compliant, you don't have a security guarantee, because there's lots of possible configurations within the standard, and some configurations are secure, and other configurations are not secure. So to limit a little bit the scope, we're going to look at a few core components of the standard. And the first component is something called a secret key object. So a secret key object holds the secret key. So this is what's used for the keys. And they're pointed to by handles. So you should imagine that the key is in here, and then the handle points to it. So I can try to do this. This handle points to the key, to the object. And each physical token may have many objects, because there might be multiple keys in here. Now, remember, we have many tokens. So one of the problems is that there might be a key here and the same key in here, and the things might move across. And then we want to make sure that usage of these keys is consistent, so that if this token thinks that it can do operations A but not operation B with a particular key, that this one also thinks it can do operation A and not operation B with it, and not suddenly start doing things that this one thinks you shouldn't be able to do with it. The other thing that you want to be able to do is to move keys across from one token to the other token. So to move things across, you use wrapping and unwrapping. And to ensure that key usage is consistent, there's something called an attribute. So the attribute will actually tell you what usage is allowed with the keys. So they determine what kind of key it is, how and when it was created, what it may be used for, and what may be done to it. So some examples: encrypt, decrypt, wrap, unwrap, trusted. So these are from the PKCS 11 standard, and these are the ones that we were going to that we have modeled in our paper. There's also attributes that tell you what you may do to the key. So for instance, an extractable key means that the key may be wrapped, whereas if the key is not extractable, then you shouldn't wrap it. Yeah, and problems occur if wrapping keys can be used to decrypt. So you have to make sure that you set these attributes in a consistent way to avoid bad interactions. So key wrapping, very quickly, is the idea is that you have two keys, you point them to each other, two keys, and one handle points to this key, the wrapping key, the other handle wraps to the key that you want to transport, and then the traditional way is that you encrypt one key under the other, and then you get your wrap, and then you move this wrap, you feed this into token, and then this token, you hope that the wrapping key is already there, and then you give it the wrap, and then it will be able to create the KT. So then KT is on here as well. So traditionally, the mechanisms for key wrap differ from ordinary modes of operation. So for those people who went to the morning session, there were various talks on like modes of operation for authenticated encryption, and this is slightly different because you don't want to have the different standards are involved. So a slightly more modern treatment of key wrap, you add associated data. So this is due to Shrimpton and Rogoway. And these associated data are excellent mechanisms to help you to authenticate attributes when you transport keys. And we also show that, in fact, this works the way you'd like it to work. Yeah. So some guidance on how you should use these attributes. For instance, if you wrap, then the extractable attribute should be set to true, because if it's not, you're not allowed to do it. So in some cases, if you say to the token, do this, it will actually refuse to do it. The other thing to notice is to wrap any secret key with any other secret key, consideration must be given to key size and mechanism strength of the token, or the token may not allow the operation. So if you think about how security is normally modeled, people will use maybe asymptotic security or concrete security, but even in concrete security, people typically fix on a particular key length and express everything in that key length. Whereas it's clear that in this world, you actually need to be able to deal with multiple key sizes at the same time. So this creates an abstraction difficulty that we have to deal with as well. And then there are things that if you unwrap, so first we wrapped and then you unwrap, there are some things that are also shouldn't be set or should be set. Yeah. So the conclusion is that there can be attribute clashes. So a non-sensitive key may become sensitive because you could try to change the attribute. Or a wrapping key may become a decryption key, which is also bad because then there's an attack. So one of the things to prevent this is that you want to make sure that these attributes, they stay the same or they can't move in bad directions.
Good.
So what are then, with this background of what PKCS 11 is, what are then our goals? So the first thing is we said, okay, we want to do everything for encryption, authentication, authenticate encryption all at the same time. So we need an abstract correctness notion for the primitive. And based on this, we need to say, well, if the primitive is correct, we should also be able to say what it means for the overall system to be correct. So porting this correction notion to that correction notion. Similarly for security. So ultimately, when you have a cryptographic API, you want to be able to not just move keys around, you want to use it. And then what secure encryption means entails, that implies something for what secure cryptographic API entails. And then there are additional notions for correct and secure key management API. So what does it mean for the key management to be secure? And then the main theorem in our paper is that correct and secure implementation of a primitive, correct and suitably secure key management API implies correct and secure cryptographic API. So the theorem itself, if you state it like this, is of course common sense. This is what we wanted. But actually proving it and writing it all down is extremely complicated. So I'm not going to go into the details. Firstly, I don't have the time. And secondly, well, I'm not sure whether the screen has the right resolution to actually get the games all on there in one go. So I'll show you the simplest game we have, and then I think you will understand why I'm not going into a ridiculous amount of detail. So we're certainly not the first ones to look at the security of cryptographic APIs. So Cushing, as someone sometimes writes it, and Chandran, they already looked at a very particular cryptographic API. But there's a couple of the advantage is that it's the first computational definition of security. It's game based, and multiple users are supported. But the problem is that you can only have a single token. Also, the security notion is a little bit specific to the construction. It's a bit mingled, so you have to work actually quite hard to get a security notion that's more general. And keys cannot be corrupted. There's another work by Kramer, Steele, and Marinsky, where they provide three models. So do you think three models? Surely they must have done everything by then. But only one of them is game-based computational, and unfortunately that model is actually ill-defined. So that's not really doing what we want either. There's also a universally composable one, but I'll refer to the paper for further details on that. Yeah. Now, our work also has limitations, so because I gave limitations of previous work, I think it's fair to at this point also say what the limitations of our work are. So, for instance, because we look at a selection of PKCS 11, there's many things we don't model. For instance, we don't model key derivation or destruction. We don't deal with key identities or key zones, or with public key methods, which actually are being used quite a bit. And we don't have a concept of sessions or authenticated users. So some of these things, they are, you'd think they'd be easy to add, but they will actually blow up your notation, your games. They will blow up it. They will blow it up quite considerably. The other problem is maybe more significant because, as I said, we deal with abstract primitives. So then the question is, what kind of primitives can you actually deal with, and what are the limitations? For instance, we can only deal with stateless primitives. So nonce-based is fine, but if you have stateful encryption, that's not fine. We can also only deal with single key security notions. So for instance, security notions that are where you have multiple, where you have key dependent message security based on multiple keys at the same time, they are not supported at the moment. And as I said, public key primitives are not supported because all the keys are symmetric, so you can't do public key primitives. So I promised I will show you one of the games to just to know why I didn't put them all on here. So a cryptographic primitive. So this is the syntax for cryptographic primitives. How do you model abstractly a cryptographic primitive? So you have the key generation, and then you have an algorithm that uses the key and on some input. And then the game consists of four algorithms. So there's the setup, which sets up a security game and initializes. You have two different challenge oracles, because we're playing an indistinguishability game. So there's the left challenge oracle and the right challenge oracle. And then there might be oracles that are the same in both worlds. So these are the auxiliary oracles. Excuse me. So then you play a distinguishing game, and we add also the ability to corrupt games, corrupt keys. Yeah, so the code for this, so this is the simplest game we have, looks like this. Yeah, so it's not actually important that you understand what's written here. So I'm quickly clicking to the next slide. So when you then port this notion of a cryptographic primitive to the API setting, you need to have some notation that deals with cryptographic APIs. So as we said, we have these tokens. So this is the physical token, I mean, the place the physical token. And then you want to abstract it. Yeah. So they have a state, these tokens have a state. They have a unique identity. So this is token pink, and this is token yellow and green. And they have a number of associated handles, because there might be multiple tokens, multiple key objects in here, and there's handles pointing to these keys, and different handles might even point to the same key. And these handles belong to a unique token, so if you know the handle, you know which token it belongs to. The link is associated with the attribute, so that's why we have this notation. Yeah? And then you come to the syntax. So we can link the syntax of the PKCS commands with the commands in the API syntax, and then there's also a corresponding oracle in the API game. So I'll just list them all very quickly, so you can create, wrap, unwrap, and you can actually run the primitive that you might want to run. Plus you can corrupt keys in the game, but obviously not for real. There is not a PKCS command, please corrupt the key. That would be silly. So with these commands, you will see that there's a notion of equivalence. So this notion of equivalence actually harks back to the earlier papers by Kasia Chandra and also Kramer Steele Rinsky. So you create a key, and then you get a handle as an adversary. Then you transfer this key to another token, so then you get another handle, and then ideally these two handles point to, as a key cryptographically objects, the same thing. So you want that, so this is why we define an equivalence class using indices. And then if you create yet another key and you start wrapping, so you wrap this new key under H1 and then you unwrap it under this key which was the same as that, you get H4, so now H4 and H3 should also be the same, so this is written there. So there's this notion of equivalence, and then what you can also see that if you encrypt, or if you wrap like this, and I give you W and I corrupt KW, then what do you also learn? KT, yeah? So if I give you this and this, then you can just run decryption yourself. Yeah? So this is why single corruption can lead to many compromises. So the solution, and this is a refinement of an earlier mechanism by Cachin and Chandra and KSW, is to use a graph describing the wrapping dependencies between all these equivalence classes. So I'll skip that one. Yeah, so security is that any uncompromised key can be challenged in the primitive security game. Security of the key management API is that any key that is not compromised looks random. So this is what you expect. This is the same as a chem notion. And then stickiness is that these attributes, they stay the same. So in PKCS, they can change because you have monotonicity, so slightly different. And then our composition result is the obvious one, namely that P is a primitive. So if you use one set of keys only for wrapping and one set of keys you only use for the primitive, then the composition is secure. So you have a layering to deal with it. Yeah? So that's the theorem. Okay. Yeah, so we've achieved this suitable level of abstraction, secure cryptographic primitive, find all these things, we can deal with this. Okay. So challenges are these. So challenges, leave it there. That's it.
All right, can we thank the speaker, please?